Okay, so let's come to the cytological techniques used for the diagnosis of the cancer. Here we have used the needle. Here I'm telling you the technique called FNAC. But first, before that, I told you cytological techniques. Okay. So please remember, cytological techniques which can be used for cancers, okay, can be number one. First, remember always, all of you should remember, we can have a technique called as exfoliative cytology. Okay, so exfoliative cytology means where you collect the shed cells, okay, cells are getting shed in the secretion, then you take them, like pap smear. So pap smear, you take up the cells which are shed, okay, so you take from squamocolumnar junction, you just scrape it and take out the all shed cells. Or bronchoalveolar lavage, now you put the water, shake it, move it and take out the fluid, all the cells which are shed in that fluid come out. Or gastric lavage, okay, so again the same thing, you put it in the stomach, you just rinse it and just take it out, okay, gastric lavage. So all these are exfoliative cytology. Then we can have fine needle aspiration cytology. Fine needle aspiration cytology. See, fine needle aspiration cytology you do when a person has developed a lump. Okay. And when he has developed a lump, you take out the cells from the lump. Only the cells. You are just trying to take out cells from the lump by just moving the needle in different directions. So if I talk about FNACs, we can have two basic techniques of the FNACs. To understand the two techniques, I will show you two videos. Okay, so you have to spot the difference between the two videos, just like used to play that game, no, identify the difference between the two cats, like that. So look at this video number one. So both of these are my own patient and this is my own resident who is doing the technique. Okay, so let's see this. This is technique number one. Look at the technique number two. So, what was the difference between the two videos? So, first, if you look at the video number one, okay, if you look at the video number one, here you're using this syringe and a holder to aspirate out the cells. So this technique is called as fine needle aspirate cytology because you are aspirating the cells. Look at this, here you are not using a syringe, okay, just taking out the cells like that. So what is this called as? Fine needle non-aspirate cytology. This is called as fine needle non-aspirate cytology. Okay, so if we want to differentiate both the techniques, remember, why do we differentiate? See, whenever some tumors which you expect are very, very vascular, okay, then you do not want to put a needle in it, okay, you don't want to put a syringe in it, because if you put syringe in it and you try to aspirate, then blood will come, and when blood will come, it will dilute all the cells and you will not be able to see the morphology. So like this case, this is an axillary lymph node in a patient whom we are suspecting lung carcinoma. So if I would have put syringe in it, I would have aspirated more blood, because this is expected to be very vascular, isn't it? So I would prefer to do it fine needle non-aspirate cytology. I won't want to aspirate it, okay, with the syringe. Whereas look at this patient here, this is probably a case of this was a lymph node, and on palpation it felt like a tubercular lymph node. I didn't felt it like a malignancy, so I knew it will not be very vascular, so I could put the syringe and I could do it as with aspiration. So I prefer to do fine needle aspiration. Similarly, if I'm saying thyroid lesions are very vascular, so thyroid lesion should always be done in a non-aspirate manner, so because they are very, very vascular, so if blood comes, they will just dilute your morphology and then you will not be able to see the correct lesion at all. Okay, so remember everybody, so we have two techniques now. We have started fine needle aspiration and fine needle non-aspiration. So once you're clear with this, now let us see that what is the gauze size that you use for FNAC. So if I'm saying the gauze size, it's usually a very thinner needles which we use. We're ranging from 22 gauze to 25 gauze, okay. So we usually use the needle from 22 gauze to 25 gauze needles. So 25 gauze needles are usually used for thyroid lesions because they're very vascular. So we use very thin needles, okay. So more the vascularity, when you expect more vascularity, you use more thinner needles. So bigger the size of the gauze, thinner is the needle, okay. Okay, so 25 gauze needle is a very thin needle which you use. Okay, so once you have aspirated the cells, immediately you spread them on slide. When you spread them on slide, now two things can happen. When you spread them on slide, you can do two things. One, either you leave them for air drying. Okay, or you immediately fix them. Immediately fix them in 95% ethanol. So now once you've done that, okay, so either you leave them for air drying or you fix them at 95% ethanol. So when you leave them for air drying, okay, then you usually air drying, usually you put Jimsa stain on them. Okay, so when you put for air drying, you get Jimsa stain. Whereas when you're fixing it with 95% ethanol, then you're going to put Papanicolo stain on them. Okay, usually Papanicolo stains can be put in this. Okay, usually we put that stain. Okay, so that if it is fixed, you will use Papanicolo stain, and if you air dry it, you will just stain it with Jimsa stain. Okay, of course, nuclear morphology is better preserved in pap. Okay, so nuclear morphology is better preserved in Papanicolo stain. So we prefer that for seeing the nuclear morphology in a better way. Now, what is the problem with FNAC? See, FNAC, you are just aspirating predominantly the cells. So the 3D orientation of cells with stroma is not visible. Okay, so some tumors in which it is mandatory for you to see the stromal invasions, capsular invasions, in that cases, you will not, FNAC will not be very helpful. Okay, so remember, like, let me tell you, follicular thyroid carcinomas. So you cannot differentiate between follicular adenoma and follicular carcinoma on FNAC slides, because for labeling it as a follicular carcinoma, you should be able to see vascular invasion and capsular invasion, which you can't see in FNAC. So therefore, such cases are reported as just follicular neoplasms on cytology, and then the confirmatory diagnosis is always done on biopsy. You understand that? So that is the first thing we have to know. Second is, in some organs we should not do FNAC at all. Like ovarian and testicular. Okay, ovarian and testis. So remember, testis, if you do FNAC in the testicular tumors, what will happen is that it will metastasize. It will come and involve the skin of the testis. Okay, you will give a root. You will form a root and cancer cells will metastasize to the skin and you will upgrade the tumor. Now, you know, I'll tell you my experience which I faced. Okay, so can you tell me which testicular lump does not, testicular tumor does not produce with testicular lump? All of you know, most common manifestation of a testicular tumor is testicular lump, isn't it? But there is a testicular tumor which does not produce testicular lump. This testicular tumor is choriocarcinoma. So remember, whenever choriocarcinoma occurs in male, the testicular lump size is usually less than 2 cm. Okay, so size is very, very small, and they do not suspect that this is testicular carcinoma. I'll tell you my example. Okay, so when I was a resident, okay, so there was a my contemporary postgraduate in the surgery, he brought a patient to us. He said, this is a testicular, he doesn't have a testicular lump, this is a small nodule, it was less than 0.5 cm. So he said, might be filariasis. So we want to start the testicular, we want to start the therapy for filaria. Can you please do FNAC for this? So we saw, normally as a protocol, testicular lumps, okay, if you're suspecting malignancy, you will not do FNAC. So when we saw that, he said, yes, the lump is very small, 0.5, could be filariasis or could be just calcinosis cutis. Okay, so let's do an FNAC and see what is it. So when we did FNAC, it came out to be as choriocarcinoma. By the time you diagnose choriocarcinoma in males, they have already metastasized to the lung and the brain. And the prognosis is very bad. It's a very aggressive testicular tumor. And I felt so bad. That I have upgraded the lesion. Already the patient is going to die because of metastasis. Now I have upgraded the tumor. And this was one of the blunders which could happen. And I did a blunder. So I always remember this. And I always tell my students, okay. So testicular lumps should not undergo FNAC. But if a person is elderly and he is having a lump less than 2 cm, keep a possibility of choriocarcinoma also in your brain. Okay, so that should be kept in brain. Okay, so that was a learning experience. Okay, the next important is ovarian. you know, ovarian FNACs is has been a matter of debate over a long, long time, okay? So normally they say you should not do ovarian FNAC because if you do, you spill the tumor cells into the peritoneum. And if you spill this, if you spill the cells into the peritoneum, you upgrade the lesion, you upgrade the tumor. Okay, so that was a protocol, that was what was said, that you should not do the FNAC for ovarian tumors. Nowadays, there's again a resurgence going on that yes, we can do FNAC for the test ovarian tumor so that we can stage it, all that. But ideally, we should not do it because you're going to upgrade it, you're going to spill the tumor in the peritoneum. So that is the sites where you should not do FNAC. Third is, suppose if you are suspecting hydatid cyst, again, please don't do FNAC, otherwise the patient will go into anaphylaxis, okay? So that also should not be done, okay? So this again, I'm telling you, this was a case, again, I'm telling you the case which I faced again. So this was a female, this has been presented as a case report by one of my residents also, this year itself, just I think 2 months back, okay? So this was a female who came with the breast lump. There was a lump in the outer quadrant of breast, okay? And from outside somewhere she had undergone FNAC. And because FNAC was done outside, so it was reported as benign breast disease. And this female came to us for FNAC again, sent by surgery department again. So when I saw the female and I said, no, it doesn't seem like in breast, it looks like in subcutaneous tissue, let me do the FNAC. I did FNAC for this patient, and when I did FNAC, you'll be surprised to know what I found. It was hydrated. It was hydrated. Okay, I could see that hooklets of the hydrated in it. Very unusual sight, but I didn't expect it to be hydrated. Fortunately, the patient was okay. There was no anaphylaxis, but still, okay. So this was, so sometimes unusual lesions also come, isn't it? So remember, hydrated cyst, ideally you should not do it, but unknowingly sometimes FNACs are done. Okay, so this is the technique FNAC which everybody should be knowing. Okay, so that's, these are some prudent and some important points about FNAC which everybody should remember. Are you clear with this? So that's the technique FNAC, and you have learned today that you will FNACs could not differentiate between follicular adenomas and follicular carcinomas, and in ovarian and testicular lumps you should avoid doing it, and in hydrated you should avoid doing it. Okay, so that's a very small purview of FNAC which we can use for diagnosing the cancers. Okay.